It was 2007. Cassandra Voss just finished her junior year at St. Norbert College. She was on top of the world, about to embark on a study abroad trip to South Africa.
She was just very, very pleased and fulfilled and had big ideas and big plans for the future. Not specific ones necessarily, but general ones, and she was in the midst of figuring out what she was going to do.
But before she were to go overseas, Cassandra wanted to squeeze in one last trip with her friend and roommate. The roadmap was to drive to San Francisco and back, with stops in between. But in the middle of rural Nebraska, tragedy struck.
It was at 8:40 in the morning on May 21st, 2007. And that's when the accident occurred, and Cassie was killed on the scene, killed immediately.
Cassandra was 21 years old.
You know, this was God's will, and for whatever reason, even though there's no way I could understand it, I was gonna go from the premise that things do happen for a positive reason, and if I have to wait to find out what that reason is, I'll certainly do that.
Kurt's wait would last 6 years, but this is where the story comes full circle. You have a father, admittedly a conservative, who was able to find common ground with his feminist daughter, Cassandra.
She became such a spokesperson that she could out-debate a pretty good debater, her father, and teach her father in such a way that her father could know and understand.
A father's faith and determination, coupled with a daughter's dream, along with a number of amazing twists and turns along the way, has produced this. The Cassandra Voss Center, a former church built in 1883, that will house the Women's Center, the Men's Initiative, and the Women's and Gender Studies discipline.
She was my student and so beautiful in that her death is being turned into something extraordinary that will speak to people. Because we all want that. We all want to believe in transformation. And I can't believe that I'm a part of that.
Cassandra was on track to become the first St. Norbert student to complete an individualized major in Women's and Gender Studies. And she often spoke about a place on the St. Norbert campus that would welcome all gender-related programming.
It's often seen as things that we don't want to talk about, but I think when we do really intentional and strong programming, folks want to be in those spaces, and I think that's proven true on campus. And this will be an opportunity to really, really amplify those programs, and I think St. Norbert will be a leader in the entire state and country with this sort of work.
The Cassandra Voss Center is an innovative and unique facility, just like Cassandra would have envisioned it. Already, it's a space that has drawn one of the largest ever gift totals for gender programming at any college or university.
There's no doubt in my mind that God has very, very large plans for what's going to happen within those walls.
The dedication for the Cassandra Voss Center was held on September 18th. She would have been 28 years old.
She'd buy a really great dress for the opening.
I think it's a story of faith and you know, God's been very faithful to me. You know, faith isn't a one-way street. It's a two-way street, and that's been proven to me through all the various things that have helped me to continue on with the path and for this project to come to fruition.
I'm Mike Counter reporting for St. Norbert College.
We are delighted to have all of you here tonight. I'm Tom Kunkel. I'm the president of St. Norbert College. And I want to extend a special welcome to the 800 people in the room, as well as the thousands of others who are watching this via live web stream tonight. Many of you have traveled far to witness the historic conversation between two friends as part of the Bell Hooks week-long residency at St. Norbert College's Cassandra Voss Center. So we know just some of the people in the room tonight. The bulk of the house is St. Norbert College. You may have heard that the ticket release nearly broke our internet. We have community partners from nonprofits like the YWCA and the Women's Fund to corporations like Humana, Schneider, and Ameriprise. We are especially pleased to welcome colleagues from such schools as the University of Wisconsin at Green Bay, Stevens Point. Green Bay, Stevens Point, Marshfield, River Falls, Madison, as well as Lawrence University, Ripon, Beloit, and Loyola, just to name a few, and welcome to all our friends. We even have a 16-year-old who traveled from Arkansas with her mom to see this dialogue as part of her independent high school project. Yeah. Good job, Mom. My mom wouldn't have done it. We have alumni watch parties of this live-streamed event and social justice organizations as far away as South Texas that are tuning in with us tonight. We are so delighted to welcome back Bell Hooks for this week-long residency. Many of you may have seen her last year when she was here for 2 days, but in that time, Bell has come to call our own Cassandra Voss Center a sister center to her newly opened Bell Hooks Institute at Berea College in Kentucky, which opened just last week. And now I'd like to introduce two wonderful colleagues, Dr. Carlin Crowley, director of the Cassandra Voss Center and professor of English and Women's and Gender Studies, and Anna Zarnick-Niemeyer, Cassandra Voss Center assistant director and alum of the college. And they are going to introduce tonight's special guests. Carlin, Anna.
Doing a lot of that tonight. My name is Carlin Crowley. Many of you know that Cassandra was my student. I want to begin with an email. November 9th, 2005. Cassandra would often write me late at night. She was responding to Gloria Steinem's piece called Supremacy Crimes and pulls out a quotation, quote, "A powerful statement that Steinem makes is, quote, we will never reduce the number of violent Americans from bullies to killers without challenging the assumptions on which masculinity is based." Cassandra responds, "I really like this article." And I think it was a great source at seeing how gender, class, and homophobia work together to oppress women. That was Cassandra's persistent insight to see how identity is interrelated and to remedy with analysis, action, and with love. And at the Cassandra Voss Center, we live and work in that spirit.
My name is Anna Zarnick-Niemeyer. I am a proud alum of St. Norbert College and also the assistant director of the Cassandra Voss Center. We wanted to share with you our core values of the Cassandra Voss Center that speak to the vision of these incredible women and also the relationship between Kurt and Cassandra, and tell you a little bit more about how this night will run together, how this party will run together tonight. Let's be honest. So the Cassandra Voss Center is scholarship-driven, welcoming, innovative, and fun. What does that mean? We're scholarship-driven, meaning that we are grounded in theory and practice in the field of women's and gender studies and identity studies. We are welcoming. We are welcoming of all people around the table, into the building, and into the conversation. We are innovative. We offer cutting-edge content, programs that intrigue, that spark curiosity, and that feel a little like a party. Finally, we're fun. We believe that delight resists tyranny, and we're delighted to be here tonight. You may see out back in the lobby that there are postcards out there for you to learn more about the rest of the residency. Yes, there is a week of party happening here at the Cassandra Voss Center at St. Norbert, and we'll learn more about the residency events at the end of our talk today. Also, you may have seen on the screen that we are a social media-friendly audience here tonight. So if you are live tweeting, and we hope that you might, you can use the hashtag SNCBellHooks15 and tweet us at SNCCVC. Also in the lobby, there's an opportunity for you to check out some cards that will let you give in your information to us so we can keep in contact with you. And as we always say, if you like us on Facebook, we'll like you for real. Also, you'll see staff in these fabulous t-shirts, transformative thinking, and they're here to help you. This is how our party will run tonight. We'll get to enjoy a dialogue between these two incredible women on my left. Then we'll have some time to do a question and answer after the dialogue. And then we'll flip the space and there will be a book signing on the stage here. after the talk. As always, we welcome you into our center, which is just across the way at 311 Grant Street, right across from the Cress Inn. It's open until 10 p.m. tonight and all day tomorrow. Finally, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank our incredible student staff who you see in the t-shirts here tonight who have helped us all along the way, and particularly to our special projects coordinator, Karen Clearman. And this would be impossible without those staff. So thank you. And last but not least, our incredible sponsors that make this night possible for us all to be here. We want to thank Faculty Development at St. Norbert, Humana Insurance, Human Resources, the Colleen Chair of Theology and Philosophy, Multicultural Student Services, the Office of Communications, and also Kurt Voss himself. It takes a village, people, and we're all here together. And now to introduce our speakers.
We want to thank Gloria Steinem, not just for joining us here tonight with her longtime friend, Bell Hooks, but for the lifetime of work that precedes her. You can thank Gloria Steinem if you've ever participated in Take Your Daughter to Work Day, a national day to inspire girls to become leaders. If you recognize the need for domestic violence shelters, you know that the Women's Action Alliance that Steinem helped co-found in the 70s helped create them. You can thank Gloria Steinem if you believe women should be involved in politics because she helped found the National Women's Political Caucus for just that purpose. If you're a woman wanting pay equity, you'll know Steinem helped create the Coalition of Labor Union Women. You can thank Gloria Steinem if you've ever read a women's magazine with substance, like the legendary one started by Steinem in the 70s, Ms. Magazine. You can thank Gloria Steinem if you enjoy accurate and complete media, like the kind produced by the Women's Media Center, co-founded by, guess who? Gloria Steinem. And if you've ever seen either film that Gloria Steinem has produced, Private Violence, recently out on HBO about domestic abuse, or Multiple Personalities, The Search for Deadly Memories, about mental disorders, you're better for it. For these and a few hundred other reasons, you can thank Gloria Steinem. So, as the face of the women's movement and author or editor of 8 books, we all know the monumental step she has taken in the name of politics, journalism, the workforce, women, the media, and so much more. Yet, even with so many accomplishments, Steinem continues to surprise. Did you know that she has her own children's book named after her? Or that she was just a judge at the Tribeca Film Festival this year? Or perhaps that she's currently working on a project to document the grassroots origins of the US women's movement? Or, as I learned tonight, that she's about to interview Miss Piggy in 2 weeks. I know. Gloria Steinem leaves us in awe. We're especially overjoyed that she made time for us before setting off on her peace walk across the demilitarized zone between North and South Korea. Maybe some of you read that in the New York Times in the past month. I have to ask, what does a legendary feminist even take on a cross-country walk? Water, snacks, aviator glasses, a Bell Hooks book? Gloria Steinem, we are thrilled to hear more as you speak tonight in conversation with Bell Hooks. So let us welcome Gloria Steinem for the third time back to St. Norbert College.
And now for Bell Hooks. In our St. Norbert College community, Bell Hooks needs no introduction. Around this time last year, some of you may have gone to Sacred Hour to hear Dr. Hooks speak about love and spirituality. Or maybe you visited the Cassandra Voss Center, where she read 2 of her 5 children's books to 200 local elementary school students. And some of you may have even been in this very room 1 year ago where Dr. Hooks gave her moving lecture on ending domination. Woo! It was good. Bell Hooks comes to St. Norbert with a lifetime of scholarship, books, and social justice activism. She is one of the most well-known scholars on issues of racism, sexism, homophobia, and classism.
Dr. Hook started writing her first book, Ain't I a Woman, Black Woman and Feminism, at the age of 19. What have you done lately? And since then has written nearly a book every year, now over 40 books. Because of Dr. Hook's great scholarly reach, her work has touched countless disciplines, including English, sociology, religious studies, education, and others. Because the Cassandra Voss Center has become a sister center to the Bell Hooks Institute at Berea College in Kentucky, our staff has witnessed nationally firsthand the impact of Hooks' work. People spontaneously burst into tears, as I'm about to do, upon meeting her. They describe how her work has literally saved them from despair, depression, hopelessness. Hooks is also well known for her public responses to pop culture, commenting on all subjects and people, from Orange is the New Black to Beyonce. Rumor has it that in addition to writing books, Dr. Hooks voraciously reads every day. And this is not a rumor, I happen to know, a book a day, sometimes two. And perhaps only relevant to this audience, but nonetheless imperative to know, Bell Hooks loves Tsurugi's dark chocolate turtles, above all. But more importantly tonight, it's crucial to know that Dr. Hooks has a special relationship with our other guest speaker, Gloria Steinem. Bell Hooks and Gloria Steinem have been close friends for over 20 years. Both women have distinctly different backgrounds across race, class, geography, yet they have been able to connect across difference. Their lively friendship has fostered important conversations from Berea to Kentucky to Manhattan to Atlanta, including the one that you will hear tonight. These two women continue talking to one another about the issues most relevant to all of our lives. Kurt Voss and Cassandra, as you saw in the video, followed Hooks and Steinem's model. It's this ability to stay in conversation that will ground us, connect us, and save us. Please join us for the second time in welcoming Dr. Bell Hooks.
I said earlier tonight, I'm a Norbertine. This is one of the places that I can call home in this world. I'm excited to be here with my bud, Gloria. When I told her about the Cassandra Voss Center and I really hoped we could come here and talk together, she immediately said, okay. And I want to begin. I've been here, I came Sunday, I've been tooting the horn of Paul Waddell's book, Becoming Friends. And one of the sentences in that book made me think about Gloria and myself. Friendship, he writes, is a lesson in the discipline of love. I met Gloria after falling down a hill in Skowhegan, at the art school there, and we were taking a picture for the cover of Ms. Magazine. And some of you are old enough to remember that cover with Gloria, myself, Irva Shivade, and Naomi Wolf. But I had a big cast on my arm. And Gloria, who had read my work and was supportive, was very concerned about my having the right shirts that I could put on by myself. So by the time I had arrived back home, then I was at Oberlin, she had sent me a box full of shirts. She kept telling me, but Belle, it was your work. I said, for me, it was the present. I really was so touched that she cared enough. And to me, that's one of the real traits of Gloria. She cares. She cares about the suffering in the world. And she cares about injustice. And she teaches us how to care. So I'm happy to be here with her tonight. I thought we might start by, you know, just asking each other about when did we become interested in feminism?
That long ago, we're going to start up there. Actually, I shouldn't say that.
Longer for some than others.
I I shouldn't say that long ago because I'm so much older than practically anybody here. I'm trying to convince myself of my age, so I keep announcing I'm 81. Hello. Right. That, I mean, I was past 30 before feminism dawned on me. You know, I thought I could escape the system but not change the system up to then. And it wasn't until I saw other people being rebellious and dissident and so on. I mean, if you can't see it, you can't be it. That's what's so important about all of us being together in this room. And because I went as a reporter to cover a hearing about abortion that was held in a church basement in New York, because there had been a hearing held in the New York State Legislature on liberalizing the law. This was just before the Supreme Court ruling. And at the state legislature, they had invited 14 men and one nun to testify. You can't make this stuff up. You know? So a bunch of early feminists in New York said, wait a minute, let's talk to women who've really had this experience and hear their stories. And I went to cover it, but of course I was drawn to it for reasons I had had the same experience. I didn't understand why I was drawn to it. But that was the moment of the kind of light coming on for me, because I suddenly realized, you know, if one in three of us in this nation then and now has had this experience at some time in our lives, why is it illegal? Why is it dangerous? Why? Who owns women's bodies? Who says we can't, you know, control our own reproductive lives? And that, you know, that was the beginning of both asking questions and also realizing I wasn't by myself. That's key.
Whereas for me, of course, I was a member of the birth control generation. I was an undergraduate at Stanford, where Carl Girasi was handing out his birth control pills to the world, and my favorite feminist teacher, Diane Middlebrook, was one of the first people whose courses she passed out a poem, which happened to be one I had written, and asked my fellow students, is this by a woman or a man? And we confronted that whole issue of, does gender overdetermine whether you can be a writer or not? And so those were heady days of learning about our status as women, being told by male professors at Stanford that we couldn't be writers and thinkers because we'd all get married. And, you know, my first women's studies class was there with Tilly Olson. I stand here ironing. I was 19 years old, and I began to write Ain't I a Woman, Black Women and Feminism, because as Tilly talked about, you know, women being at home, and I kept thinking, I don't know women who are at home, because black women that I know, like my mother and other women, are out in the workforce working. And that was the beginning for me of thinking about the differences of race and womanness, and the beginning of me writing about that before we had terms like intersectionality.
And I think also the beginning for me had to do with realizing that, you know, I know intersectionality is the word of the day academically. To me, it's intertwined race and sex, because I fear that intersection sounds like one place, you know, like a crossroads, and it seems to me deeply intertwined, so you can only uproot both of them together, because in order to maintain racism, or at least some visible difference, you have to control reproduction, which means you have to control the bodies of women. So the so-called superior group, if white women, are restricted, and women of color are exploited. It affects women differently, but you can't maintain racism without sexism. So it just seems to me there's just no way to be a feminist without being anti-racist, and there's no way to be successfully anti-racist without being, you know, they're just too deeply intertwined.
I was telling Gloria earlier that that's why I imagined the phrase imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy without, again, a word like intersectionality, but I hoped that people would see how all of those things were linked and how it was impossible to take one thing out of it and say, okay, this is how we'll end domination without thinking about how we will we end all aspects of it.
Yeah, no, I think we were talking a little bit, not that we're more like a jazz duo here. We're riffing away. So it's not like we planned everything, but we were talking a little bit, and I was saying I think that connectedness, interconnection, is really our theme. And it's important now because we are still seeing the movements, social justice movements, are still seen in silos, you know, like they're like this, without seeing how they're connected. You know, like on campuses like this, somebody will say to me, well, why are the same groups against lesbians and birth control? You know? Seems irrational to them. But it's not irrational because the patriarchal system that Bella's talking about, it controls reproduction and says it's only moral and okay when it can end sexuality, sexual expression can end in reproduction. And everything else is wrong. So that means sexual expression between two men or two women. It means women's ability to control it ourselves. It means, so, you know, sometimes I fear that our adversaries understand the connections better than we do. So I think we better, you know, truly understand why it's all connected.
Well, I was wondering about that, Gloria, because I'm almost 20 years younger than you. That
she doesn't tell me that all the time, just some.
I was wondering how you perceive where we've come. Of course, for me, you know, a country girl raised in a fundamentalist Christian home, coming to Stanford, writing these feminist books, it was a long journey for me. When you look back from then to now, what do you see as some of the big unresolved issues and some of the resolved issues?
Well, I'm not sure that anything is resolved, but I think we tend to go through stages of first consciousness, you know, of understanding it doesn't have to be this way. It's not human nature. It's not inevitable. And that usually comes out of telling our stories. You know, we say some unsayable thing, and we hear a dozen other people say, you've had that experience, so have I. You realize it's political, you can get together and change it. So it's usually something like consciousness, then you begin to spread that consciousness and see the impediments, whatever it is, in the law or in process, change the process, and then it gets to be part of the culture. And I just think you can track almost each issue and see that. But I still think that where we are, how shall I say, we're still declaring independence, not interdependence. And you know, independence has to come first. You know, you have to be visible first, you have to name yourself, you have to, you know, but then you do get to interdependence. And there's a book that I find very helpful and I commend to you called Sex and World Peace, by Valerie Hudson and other scholars, but it's readable, even though it's written by scholars. and it demonstrates that the single biggest determinant of whether a country is violent inside itself, in the street and so on, or that country will be willing to use military violence against another country is actually not poverty, not access to natural resources, not religion, and not even degree of democracy. It's violence against females. That's what normalizes all other violence. Now, this is by not to say that female life is any more important than male life, or it's not. But because of the whole patriarchal control of reproduction and controlling women, you see this first, usually, you know, whether it's just dominance or whether it's violence, or and then it normalizes everything else, class, race.
I thought she also made the point in the book that especially in countries, and many of them third world countries, where the status of women is changing, then the violence becomes more intense. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like the book in this country is, as women grow stronger, men love football more. And one of the points of that book was that as women begin to challenge notions of inequality and rise in all areas of life, patriarchal men had to keep seeking out, well, where is an area that women don't have a voice or a space of power? Because so much of what we once believed about gender, people don't believe anymore. I used to tell my students that, you know, I used to hear all the time when I was, you know, young, that women couldn't be pilots because we didn't have the upper arm strength needed. And I would say to people, I now teach the male children of those women who are pilots. And so that those are the ways in which we can see lots of change brought on by feminist movement.
Yeah, in my generation, it was that you couldn't type. I mean, that men couldn't type because it took fine motor skills and, you know, stuff like that.
Little hands.
And so women were, you know, constantly being the poorly paid clerical workers and typists and so on. And, you know, it was so amazing. The minute computers came along, men could type like that.
I think about that a lot because feminism gets so maligned. But I think of feminism as one of the most amazing, in many ways, quiet revolutions. I mean, that was a revolution. The idea that men could, in fact, type. I mean, it changed so much for men and women in the workforce. And there's so many other changes that we can cite.
Yeah, and I
cite.
Think, as you were speaking, I was thinking about domestic violence, because I think also what we've learned is that the microcosm is also the macrocosm, you know, so domestic violence, what we know from family violence, turns out to be true in the big world as well. And it's both the good news and the bad news. That is, we know that a woman or a man, but it's usually a woman in a case of domestic violence, is most likely to be killed when she is just about to escape or has just escaped. Because it's about control and she's leaving control, right? I think in a way this is where the country is now. Because in about 20 minutes, it's not going to be a majority European-American white country anymore.
So the violence
the same groups are against immigration that are against sex education in the schools. They keep telling us the white race is committing suicide, on and on and on. I mean, it seems to me good news that we're going to be more diverse. We'll understand the rest of the world better.
Absolutely.
But we don't seem to be able to convince. But people who, it's not the majority, I don't think. Maybe if you look at the public opinion polls, it's maybe about a third. But people who really deeply believe that this is a white, European-American, Christian, male-dominated country, their whole identity depends on that. And so, you know, this is a moment, I would say, of maximum both danger and opportunity, you know, so we have to look after each other and be careful, but we also have to understand that we're not going to stop. You know, just as we would not tell somebody to stay in a violent situation, we're not going to tell the country to stop, and we could be about to be much more free. I mean, it's that kind of transition.
Well, you made me think about the whole demand that I see starting with women of color and Black women in particular, that white women begin to challenge their assumption that gender was the most important thing. When I went to Stanford and I was beginning to think about gender, I would hear white women say, you know, when a baby is born, the first thing people want to know is the gender. And I thought, no, that's not the case for black people. When the baby is born, the first thing black people think about as the baby is coming out of the womb is, what color is it? Because we know the extent to which color will determine that child's fate. So that right there for us was that intersection of gender and race that so many white women just didn't want to accept. I mean, white women who had come to power arguing that white men had the power and they were victims did not want to hear black women and other women of color saying, let's look at how race makes a difference. And one thing that's been special about Steinem is she has been absolutely consistent in being open to hearing how race changes the picture. I mean, a lot of tension happened in feminist movement where people fell away because they felt like women of color were taking over. Gloria was not one of those women.
No, I mean, listen, I learned feminism way disproportionately from women of color. I mean, to me, in my heart, African-American women especially invented feminism because that's sort of where I learned feminism, the National Welfare Rights Organization, you know, the women who, Flo Kennedy, who was my lecture partner, who, you know, because there was just, if you're in the labor force more and, you know, you've seen discrimination coming at you for racial reasons, you're more likely to recognize it, discrimination per se. So I've always thought that it was really wrong and unfair that the way the media covered the movement made it look as if it was mostly a white middle-class movement. And in one of the very first issues of Ms. Magazine, we printed a Lewis Harris poll, a big national poll, of women on issues of equality for women. And the result was that about 30-some percent of white women supported feminism and all these issues, and more than 60% of black women. It didn't measure other women of color just at that point.
But isn't
twice
it
as many, hello? You know,
But isn't it interesting how quickly that changed as black power movement and other movements began to say we were traitors as black females?
Well, it's not easy for, you know, like I was supposed to be dividing the anti-Vietnam movement, you were supposed to be dividing the civil rights movement. It wasn't like it was easy. We had our own little patriarchies to deal with and to help understand. But nonetheless, it was present, it was true. And, you know, it just drives me up the wall that it is not, that the reality of just people's lives doesn't get reported.
I think, too, that for me, feminism continues to amaze me as a movement for social justice, because I consider it the only movement for social justice in our nation where people involved with the movement did make a sea change, that when we begin to talk about race and class and sexuality and how all of those things together created differences among women, if you look back at the scholarship, many white women begin to change their work. They begin to change their thinking. And to me, that was awesome to think about a movement for social justice, because certainly white men on the left and black men involved in black power struggle were not sitting around looking at, this is really where we were wrong in our thinking and this is how we've made changes. So I always feel that amazing sense of gratitude as an intellectual to feminist thinking for teaching me the importance of taking new ideas, working with them, and being willing to change your mind, even if it hurts. It was very painful for some white women who had built careers around a certain way of thinking about the status of women that then had to be rethought when issues of race and class were brought into being. I think, for example, of the tremendous hostility of a Betty Friedan towards actually both of us, towards me, because I was one of the first new feminist thinkers to critique that model of the woman who is educated but at home and dissatisfied, and to say, well, wait a minute, there are a lot of women in this country for whom work was not liberating, and who looked at the woman who could stay home and raise her family as being incredibly lucky. And so that those tensions that were so fierce.
Yeah, the Feminine Mystique was a huge, important book for people whose experience it was reporting. Women,
yes.
College-educated women living in the suburbs, unable to use their experience in the work world. But it didn't speak to me either, because I was already in the work world and getting screwed. You know, I mean, it was, so I'd never, it was describing a particular experience in a very, very important way. It meant a lot to millions of women, but it was more reformist than feminist, I would say, because it was talking about a specific group of women, not about all women.
But we hope that younger women and men who are advocates of feminism remember always the tremendous struggle, the anger, the rage, the groups that fell apart because of these differences of standpoint. So that there was, a big sea change that occurred as we began to embrace standpoint theory that would allow us to look at things from different perspectives.
There were more in the past, men of color who felt like they deserved everything that white men had.
Oh, absolutely.
And including dominance of women, right? Now, actually, at least in the public opinion polls, African-American men were always more supportive of women in political office, regardless of race, than European-American, the white men were. It was always better.
But it was still difficult. But I think we saw a tremendous change when you had a black male political leadership that was calling for patriarchy as the answer to black male pain. And we see that tension now as people focus on the killing of black males and somewhat ignore the degree to which there has been tremendous police brutality towards black females. Bitch magazine this month has an incredible article about Fannie Lou Hamer and other black women who were brutally beaten. I thought it was one of the most significant aspects of Selma was we saw how brutally beaten those women were. And we've never really heard anything about their bodies. Mm-hmm. Were some of them rendered unable to walk, mm-hmm. unable to bear children, because of how brutal the police were towards them? Mm-hmm. And those stories we are still waiting.
Right. Well, we're still, I'm sure there are many examples older than this, but it's also true that the sexual abuse of Jewish women during the Holocaust is only just now being documented.
That's right.
And part of it was that if the women survived at all, they were blamed as if they were collaborating, when in fact they were sexually tortured and abused. Some of it was that they didn't survive. Some rabbis were against talking about this because they thought it was a shame. It's been 60, how many years, and it's just now coming out. And also the book, wasn't it called Dark at the End of the Street? That's about the origins of the civil rights movement and the systematic sexual abuse of black women by white men. And that actually that was being investigated and was the cause of the Montgomery. Rosa Parks was investigating a rape case, a gang rape case of a black woman, and that happened in bus stops, and that was connected to the Montgomery bus boycott, but it's taken us all this time to learn it. So there's a double invisibility, for women of color.
And a lot of double suffering and triple suffering when we add poverty and class to that positionality. So, okay, where are we now with feminism, Gloria? Is there a movement?
Just a little question like that.
Yes. But didn't we like the smooth way I just segued into it?
Well, I think,
sometimes I can't imagine being you because you have this perspective of time. Of having been there when the movement was in its infancy. I mean, I forget how many trillions of dollars women in our society are expected to control in the next decade. I mean, we've seen a tremendous change and shift.
We've seen a tremendous shift, but the when women get a little power, they're supposed to be dominating. You know, I mean, like, okay, so women now are the majority of undergraduates, I think,
yes.
in this country. And so, you know, people say to me, oh, well, the revolution is won, now we have to worry about the men and so on. And I say, well, wait a minute, okay, just wait a minute. First of all, those women are getting a BA in order to get out of the pink-collar ghetto into the white-collar ghetto. And the fact is they're still going to earn at least $1 million less over their lifetime to pay back the debt. How many people are in debt from college?
Yeah.
This is outrageous. This is the only country in which this happened. We should be mad as hell about this. And and so women in general, women of color are going to have an even bigger differential, and white women are going to have, and you're paying back the same debt. This is outrageous. You know, we have to rise up against this. And yet this is now being, you know, the truth is that still a guy, especially a white guy, in a union job, in a blue-collar union job, is going to make more than a woman with a BA. So they're smart. No wonder they're not going to college. You know, they. Right. So the idea that there are just more of us, you know, as undergraduates, is suddenly used against us. And there's all kinds of situations in which a little power is viewed as a lot of power. And we talk about the other thing that drives me crazy is we talk about the feminization of poverty, which we should. And the racialization of poverty, which we should. But we don't talk about the masculinization of power and wealth. And the whiteization, or whatever the word would be, of you know, so because there's huge concentrations of power in this country that even in the same family, the son gets it, not the daughter.
But Gloria, then how do we talk about the amazing leaps we have made forward?
Oh, yes. You know, no.
I mean, I think this is something we always find ourselves in this kind of double bind, because so many of the anti-feminist people or the people who tell us racism has ended want to point to the amazing achievements many of us have made to say, you know, sexism is no longer a problem, racism is no longer a problem. I think it has made it very difficult for us to celebrate the achievements that we have made. I mean, I think about my own life and the fact that when I began to write these books, I found there were very few black females who had written nonfiction books. And even when we had that incredible infusion of writing by black women like Alice Walker or Toni Morrison, whom I wrote my dissertation on, it did not lead younger black women into nonfiction writing, in part because there was no money in nonfiction writing in the way that you could hope to make a lot of money writing a best-selling novel. But how do we then articulate what it is we have to celebrate?
Well, here's a big thing we have to celebrate. I mean, this is mammoth. We know we are not crazy. Okay? This is huge. I mean, we know, at least we recognize it, we're much less likely to internalize the blame. I mean, we still do internalize oppression, we know, but it's much less likely. We know the system is wrong. We know it's not our fault. We know steps to make change. We're much healthier. Women's, you know, psychological health is up by every measure, you know, because we tell our stories, we talk to each other. There are many men who are supportive and understand the masculine role is bullshit too. There is no such thing as gender. Hello, excuse me. You know, we made it up, and you know, so you know that is huge, and we've made a lot of progress, a huge amount of progress. Maybe it helps to think of it in a timeline, you know, because we're living in a Twitter age, you know, so maybe we should remember that if it took the suffragists and the abolitionists 100 years to get a legal identity as human beings, we were objects, we were ownable like this table, everybody, by law. Women of every race, black men, were owned. So if it took us 100 years to get to be citizens and human beings, it's going to take us at least 100 years to get to be equal citizens, right? And we're only, I don't know, 50 years there or something? I mean, we have at least 50 years to go, I would say, in this wave and maybe in the future. And, but we need to raise the standards. We need to understand that it's also not going to work until men are raising children as much as women are. Not only because it's, you know, otherwise women have two jobs, but also because that's how men become whole people. That's how we develop the whole... Right. And, you know, and there are lots more men who are raising kids. I bet that there, you know, the men in this room, you know, are much more likely to be close to their kids than the men in anything like my generation. Much more likely, but the job structure doesn't help. You know, I just think we can celebrate along the way, and still understand what the long-term goals are.
Well, that's what I was talking about, because culture of domination is so much a binary. You know, you're either free or slave, you're either oppressor or oppressed. And how then do we articulate how far we've come, and yet we have so much further to go? Because I think people who oppose our struggle for freedom, as Sweet Honey in the Rock says, when you work for freedom, you cannot rest. I mean, all around me, I always hear that we've already gotten where we needed to go. Our students articulate that. Well, aren't women already?
But that's just because they haven't been out there yet. I mean, you get radicalized in about 20 minutes, you know, once you're out there.
Well, I hope that you're right. I'm not sure that it's so, because I also think that we are in a time of mighty backlash, especially, I mean, I'm obsessed right now in my life with thinking and writing about spirituality and sort of looking at those areas where I feel like feminist theory. Because one of the things that we differ, Gloria's power in this world has been as both activist and writer, but mine has really been as feminist theory making. How do we begin to conceptualize new paradigms? And I think that with that in mind, it becomes very hard to talk about how do we intervene on either or thinking, on binary culture, how do we replace notions of domination with notions of mutuality and partnership? Mm. As we in fact see so much of the religious right arguing against notions of partnership.
You know, first we have to imagine it. You know, we have to say, yes. Hello, we human beings and the natural world, we are linked, we are not ranked. We are linked, we are not ranked. The paradigm is the circle, not the pyramid. There are not two sides to every question. Some have six, some have 13, some have 100, you know. It's utter bullshit that there are two sides to every question. And it's based on dividing human nature into masculine and feminine, which isn't even equally divided, since human qualities are more likely to be called masculine than feminine. But in any case, it's not. We just have to reject it.
So do you think, though, that feminism has forsaken children? Because I remember in our heyday of contemporary feminist movement, we were deeply concerned about what children were reading and how children were thinking, and we saw the education of children, education as the practice of freedom, as so crucial. And it seemed that as we moved into spheres of economic power and success, we stopped talking about children and what we needed to do for children.
You know, I don't think so, but maybe you're thinking of a circumstance that I don't know. I mean, it feels like the people who are concerned about children are disproportionately women, and including in the teachers' unions.
I'm talking about public education and the kinds of gender narratives that are being taught to children, which I find, maybe there are people in the room who know differently, to be very much the same old patriarchal narratives. And I'm talking about the way in which contemporary feminism for a moment intervened on those narratives and how we're sort of seeing a resurgence of those narratives.
No, well, that's, I think we're seeing, as you pointed out in the beginning, because we've had a front lash, now we're having a backlash. We wouldn't have had the backlash if we didn't have the front lash, you know. So there's a reassertion of gender in plastic surgery and in, you know, pink and blue and the boys and girls and all this kind of stuff, you know, get back in your boxes. But there is also transgender, transsexual, and people, there's also examples of greater freedom to choose.
I guess that's why I focus a lot more these days my thinking about children. The black girls that are the primary group and the Hispanic girls and the traffic in girls in our society and are, especially, you know, as someone who reads popular culture, the impact of popular culture on the psyches of girls. I mean, the sad thing about people really like going crazy over me saying Beyonce was a terrorist, what people neglected to say was I was talking about the traffic in girls and how she has this enormous following of girls, 10 to 12, and the whole sort of white supremacist aesthetic of the long blonde hair, the straight hair, the idea that shaking your booty, the whole, that this is a way to material success and its impact on girls was what I, at the talk in which I was talking about this, was calling attention to. And it seems to me that part of what we're always up against in imperialist, white supremacist, capitalist patriarchy is that if people aren't interested in black females and our fate or black girls, then when you try to point out something in terms of the damage that's being done to us, people often, like in that case, chop off what I'm really talking about. And let's have this stupid soundbite about Beyonce being a terrorist. So that forum that could have been a mighty forum for people on the internet to think about the disappearance of girls, the traffic in girls in this society, doesn't happen. And so,
well, it's made to seem a contest between you. You know, there are the best way to silence any less powerful group is to get you to fight with each other, if you know what I mean, and only present it as if, you know, not that it has content. And you know, that happens. It's very painful. It happens all the time. I mean, you know, white guys fight with each other all the time. Nobody says, you know, that this is right. So, it's about the issue. When we fight with each other or disagree with each other or try to really be profound in some way about something that's going on, as you were saying, it's viewed as a catfight, quote unquote, instead of being about the issue and about the practice and about the substance.
And what the impact I think that it's having is I think black women are more angry at feminism. I mean, talking about collective black women see feminism as a threat to our collective well-being than as a social movement that could be liberatory, that could speak to some of the issues that we are facing in our lives. So I was thinking about that in terms of, you know, just my black women like Audre Lorde, Toni Cade Bambara, June Jordan, so many black women who have died far too young of diseases that in some cases should have been treatable, that we're sort of going backwards so much. And even in the way people are using patriarchally the Black Lives Matter, it's another way, I mean, that there are actually black women that are talking about how we don't suffer police brutality and we need to recognize that black men are the targets. And all of that seems to me to be cause for alarm.
Yeah, no, it's that white suffering matters more than black suffering. male suffering matters more than female suffering. We were born to suffer. It's an incredible differential.
Well,
but you have to always compare it to, because it's about consciousness.
I'm interested in whether or not, as you look back at your life and forward, what are some of the regrets? What do you think feminism didn't do well? That we have a chance to have a revisionary feminist movement?
Well, I mean, we were much too nice. Because
let me just say, I think
as women, we're socialized to be nice.
A racialized moment, because nobody ever accused me of being too nice.
I don't know. No. Well, okay, I was much too nice. I won't say we.
But being serious, I mean, do you think that the movement in general was...
Too nice, yeah.
Too nice?
Mm-hmm. I think two things. One, in general, I would say we were thinking, you know, surely if we just do it right and get a degree and, you know, and conform or excel or whatever it is, that everything would be okay. That was one big error, and we continue to make it, though hopefully less. And the other one was asking Daddy. Don't ask Daddy, do it yourself, you know. Don't ask somebody who's in power, whether it's they're in power because they're white, because they're whatever. Just do it. But the form it takes, I think, on campuses, I find, is that people say, what should I do? What can I do, you know, to be effective and to make a difference and everything? And the answer is it's not what you should do, it's do everything you can.
And
every
as Pima
day.
Children says, start where you are.
Yes, right.
Start where you live.
Right. And if you want, I mean, think what you want at the end of the revolution, okay? You want humor and music and sex and fun and...
I thought you told me a while ago you weren't interested in sex.
That's true, but... But I want it, but that has to do with
but
age.
But you want me to have some.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I want to have had all the sex I had in the past, too. I mean, because, you know, all my old lovers are my friends. It's a great way of making family. You know, it's fantastic.
But wait a minute.
If you want to have that, whatever it is you want at the... There is no end of the revolution. But, I mean, whatever it is you want in the future, you have to do it every day.
Well, tell me, do you think that feminism made great strides in changing for us as women how we age?
Yeah, I think so. We still have, you know, a lot of problems. And you just look at women in public life are still less... likely to be older and so on. But it's no longer an era when women feel that 30 is the end of life, which it used to be. I mean, you know.
I sometimes think, though, that there's a generational divide, because many of my students, especially heteronormative females, feel like 30 is the end of life, and if they haven't met the man and made the marriage, especially those, you know, again, who are heteronormative, they don't feel like, they feel like they're going to lose out. As I got a lovely letter last week from a person who said in the 80s that she sat in my class and she didn't say a word, that she was very shy, but she wanted to write to me and tell me how my work had changed her life. And she said, as I was changing, my mother said to me, you can follow that lesbian mess if you want to, meaning me. But you will end up manless and miserable. And she was saying, I thought this was, we talked earlier about the need for humor. She was saying how hilarious she found this as she looks back now, because of the incredible way that feminist thinking and practice transformed her life. Mm-hmm. But I feel like that's a message that I try so hard to share with younger women, the marvelous impact of feminist movement of theory and practice on my life. The fact that I can write all of those nonfiction books, where did that power come from? So much of that power came from the liberatory nature of feminist thinking and feminist movement And of course, meeting people like yourself, who were in many ways my cheerleaders, saying, go girl, we read you, you challenge us, but we stay with you as you have stayed with me all these years. She won't even let me die. I told the students of color here that I met with, we were talking about, what do you believe in enough to get out in the streets and work for? And I said that a big issue for me in life is the right to die. And I always tease Gloria that, you know, I don't want to, you know, I think of Martin Luther King saying longevity is not everything, but Missy here wants to live to be 100. And she wants me to stay around to play with her. I think that, you know, may we live to see, I have to pause a minute and say, part of why I'm very concerned about death rights is so many women are doing the care of elder parents. And I think elder care is very much a feminist issue. Many women, like my older sister, who cared for mom and dad through their sickness and on towards their death, even in though she often cared in ways we didn't approve of, no sooner was she done taking care of them that she herself was diagnosed with early stages of dementia. And this is happening for so many female caregivers, that we care for others and we often find ourselves alone without the necessary care. And I see this as definitely a primary political issue for feminism.
No, it is, and in a way, the great role model of male caregivers is the gay community and the era of AIDS. Because then there were many men, and there still are many men, caring for their partners in that way. And it showed that men can do it. And one of a couple of men in that era, I remember standing up, who were heterosexual men, not gay men, were talked about that, how amazing it was to them to see men doing this kind of intensive caregiving, and understanding that must be within them too.
So the question becomes, again, the challenge of changing patriarchy so that more men will engage in caregiving, and so that more women who are doing caregiving can have full lives of optimal well-being. On that note, we're excited that Steinem Wynum is going to live as best she can to 100. And drag me into the future with her. We will close and open up for questions. And, you know, sometimes when we have our conversations, some people will kind of critique us later and say, oh, but you know, you just seemed kind of, it seemed kind of shallow or not deep enough. And I think those people have no idea how strife between women has torn women apart. Strife cross-racial, cross-sexual practice, and that for us, the fact that we have been able to stay together in solidarity with issues we absolutely don't agree on, but still making that place for commonality is so crucial.
And can I say a word about that? Because I think...
I'm going to charge you, but you can't.
Nothing replaces... Wait, what?
I said, I'm going to charge you, but you can't. I was teasing you.
Okay. Nothing replaces trust. Nothing on earth, you know?
Yes.
And the question is, who do we know? Who do we go to the movies with? Who do we go, who do we, as Belle would say, if you buy shoes together, you can do politics together. You know? So.
That must be why Carlin and Anna and I have been in every thrift store in Napier.
But I think this is really crucial because we approach the question of coalition building and diversity and all that stuff up there someplace. No, it's not up there. It's about, I trust Belle. I knew from Belle's writing that she was including me. And she, I guess, knew from our meeting that I was including her, you know. So, you know, there's absolutely nothing on earth that replaces that. And that means, do you know each other? Who do you go to, you know, who do you see every day? There was a friend of mine who was a feminist conflict resolution expert, which she became because she had run two women's centers, so perforce she was a conflict resolution expert. And so there was a group, 100 Black Women in New York, which is a very big, powerful, important women's organization, and also one of the big, powerful, important Jewish women's organizations, and they wanted to do something together, and it wasn't happening. So they called her up as an expert to find out, and she said, well, do your two presidents know each other? And they said, well, no, not really, just we've been talking about this, you know, coming together, but they don't really know it. She said, tell them to have lunch every week, you know, for a month, and it'll happen. And it did. They just didn't know each other. So, I mean, it's not rocket science here, you know. It's knowing each other, it's trust, it's empathy, it's putting yourself in the shoes of the other person.
I think that's why we began with the Waddell quote that friendship is a lesson in the discipline of love. So on that note, we'll open up and hear from you. We appreciate short questions. I always tell audiences, if you're going on too long with proper Buddhist loving compassion, I will tell you to stop.
But you can give us answers, too. We could use answers, too. There's a hand.
Phil already has a question.
So you can come down in line for questions in this aisle and this aisle, and we'll be happy to...
What about the folks up here? I saw some hands going up. Is there a mic up here?
What of the ERA?
Well, the ERA is actually coming back, it turns out, and you will see on CNN, look online and you'll see three reports currently on the ERA. It has to go through Congress to get out with 2/3 majority. You can understand that, you know, looking at Congress, it's not bloody likely to happen too soon, but... It is doing something else, which is going state by state, New Mexico. So it's in a different situation now, because what the arguments that stopped it before, which were women in combat, gay marriage, you know, all this is gone essentially, and also states, it was going against states' rights, and that will be gone. So I think probably, I mean, we will no longer be the single democracy in the world with no guarantee of equal rights in our Constitution, but it'll take a while.
Well, you say your name. I happen to know Phil's name, so.
My name is Cindy. I just want to say how grateful I am that 35 years ago I was sitting in living rooms and consciousness-raising groups, thanks to you, and 35 years later I'm here with my daughters.
My name is Reed. I'm a senior here at St. Norbert.
Your name?
Reed. At the Academy Awards this year, Patricia Arquette used her acceptance speech to kind of advocate for women's equal rights for pay in America. But then in the media afterwards, she was kind of lampooned for her comments she made backstage about how it's time for gay people and people of color to support women's rights. And that's the first time I really ever heard intersectionality come into the mainstream media with social reform. So how do you think we start to educate the people involved in all these social forums about the importance of intersectionality?
Well, I think, as I said, we begin where we are. And so in our daily lives, as you hear people doing the separation, that's when we have to bring the awareness of the interconnectedness of forms of domination and oppression. And when we have the larger forums, that we have to then speak to that as well. Mm-hmm.
And also those of us white folks here, you know, have an obligation, I think, to say, where is everybody? Do you know? I mean, hello, I'm going to go snowblind in this group. How come this group doesn't look like the country? You know, and because we are being restricted, we are being put in a white ghetto. We should be mad as hell. You know, why can't, you know, I only realized this from living in India when I first got out of college, and then I came home and I realized how, you know, where is everybody, you know? But we have to say it.
But Gloria, where does the desire, I have such a deep desire in my life for diversity. You know, I don't want to be in an all-black neighborhood or an all-white neighborhood. I want to be in the heart of diversity. Where does that desire come from in us?
You came out
of that little Toledo trailer park that I'm sure wasn't crawling with people of color. Where do we get it, Gloria? And how can we give it to others?
Well, you know, I just think it's in us, you know, unless somebody tells you that somebody is different. I mean, look at little kids, you know, sometimes I think we don't need to do something, we just need to take away the bad things, you know, because little kids say things like, it's not fair, you are not the boss of me, you know, which is like Revolution 101 right there. It's over. And little kids kind of actually understand that people come in different colors like flowers, you know? And why is everybody... We have to nurture that. Yeah, and just that it makes no sense. I mean, white people are a tiny minority in the world, actually.
It's so hard for you guys.
And we like to think, apparently, not that I feel this is we, but anyway, that they like to think that they're the dominant majority, even though they're about three people, you know, statistically speaking. So, right. But they don't, but then that means we're missing most people in the world. We're missing this country and the country that it's becoming. It's just self-destructive. It's just self-destructive.
Your name?
My name is Joe, and I'm actually a death care professional in the area. I work at a local funeral home, and I've always seen, I just thought it was interesting that you touched on, you know, end of life stuff. I think it's the ultimate equalizer. I think it's the thing that makes us truly all the same. You know, I see changes that are happening, and I see them happening over time. You talked about, end of life being, you know, historically a woman's job. I see hospice care is coming into that. I see male hospice nurses, nurses in general, more female doctors in general. And, you know, in 100 years, it's going to be all new people. And I think there's going to be a lot more equal of a distribution of those sorts of roles. Don't you just see that? Do you see that not happening inevitably? That's kind of how I see it, that the old, angry, you know, you might say patriarchal attitudes are just dying, and I think that that has a way of equaling out.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because the same forces that want to control birth and therefore control...
All right, talk about it.
You know, also want to control death. And I only realized this really deeply in South Africa, where the original cultures of South Africa, you know, what scandalized, it's too much to explain, but anyway, there's a tribal culture, huge, huge tribal culture, which is matrilineal and female-led, and one of the big objections of the missionaries, in addition to the fact, you know, that they decided when and whether to give birth, was that they also decided the female leaders, after they had passed on their knowledge to you know, whoever was going to carry it on, had the right to decide when to die. And that scandalized the missionaries more than anything else. So, you know, it's that power over both life and death that we have to take back for ourselves.
Your name?
Hello, my name is David. And I'm wondering what the role should be of straight, heteronormative men, white men especially, in supporting movements like this.
No, well, I don't think there is a single role. You know, what's your name?
David.
Okay. You are David. Not white, heteronormative male. You know, the question is, who are you uniquely?
But also, let's acknowledge that his very presence here is an action. So that we have to... acknowledge that there are all kinds of actions we can take in the dailiness of our lives that change things, that change people's perceptions. And we're going to have to keep moving because if we're to get all the questions going, we can't take anybody else in the line. Gloria is actually leaving our wonderful little depere tonight, so we have to keep going. Well, thank you.
I like David.
Your name?
I'm Greg, and like David, I'm a white, male, heterosexual American, and I recognize that I come from a tradition that has denigrated and eroticized and exploited the people of most parts of the world. Now, I'm a student of history and sociology as well, and I'm very conscious of the imperial white supremacist, capitalist, patriarchal hierarchies, but I'm also a product of that. So as an American and an outsider, how can I talk about the situation of women outside of my own cultural heritage without employing the same imperial narratives that were traditionally employed in the imperial century. Mm-hmm. But also, can I talk about that?
You're giving a speech.
No, I think it's good to do things for other people. It's radical when you realize you're doing it for yourself. Do you know what I mean? So you too have been dehumanized by, you've been told some qualities are feminine and not masculine, you're not supposed to express them. You've been told you're not connected to some. When you get angry on your own behalf, that you too are a prisoner of gender, you know, then it's much more likely to persist. I mean, I think before I went to India, I thought I was a good person. But when I came back, I got mad on my behalf. Why? What am I doing here in this segregated society? And I think I was a more reliable ally because of that. The masculine role is a prison. It may be a better, you know, may have wall-to-wall carpeting and people to serve you coffee, but it is a prison nonetheless.
Hi, I'm Anne. 30 years ago, when I was home with three babies, one thing that kept me sane was Ms. Magazine, so thank you. But one of my favorite parts was Stories of Free Children.
Yes.
And reading them to my children gave me tools to teach them many things. Plus, they were such excellent literature. And Iris Sleeps Over, Baby X, I'm sure many in the room know a lot of these stories. And also the no comment section on the back was good for conversations. And then when my kids saw the stories later on in schools and brought them home, yada, yada. But they gave me the tools to teach many things me and my children needed to learn. Any chance of incorporating that in Ms. Magazine? Because they've not been in there for a long time.
I don't know. I'll ask them. It's true. That's a good idea. I was just thinking when you were talking that I was sorry we didn't publish. The timing wasn't this right to publish Happy to be Nappy, which was her great children's story. No,
I'm cutting you off. I think that was enough. We're going to have... Your name?
Hi, my name is Janice Severy-Dushinska. I'm from Lexington, Kentucky. I guess you live next door to one of my friends, Elise Andre, near Berea. I wanted to say that I'm an ordained Roman Catholic woman priest. I didn't know if you were aware. And I'd like to thank you both.
Does the Pope know?
Oh, yes. I just got my formal excommunication papers from the Diocese of Lexington seven or eight years after my ordination in 2008. But I especially would like to thank both of you and Bell Hooks, because in 1997, when I was reading your book, it helped me to discern to ask for ordination in 98 at the Lexington Cathedral when I was 48 years old. And we have a documentary, as Father Roy Bourgeois always says, a movement has to have a documentary. And ours is Pink Smoke Over the Vatican. So from our Association of Roman Catholic Women Priests, This is your gift.
Thank you. Now, all of you may have noticed that people are not abiding by being short in your questions and responses. So let's try to keep in mind the time. Your name?
Hi, I'm the person who drove all the way from Arkansas to be here.
Awesome!
I'm writing my senior paper on erasure and exploitation of sexualities and genders in the media, and I was wondering if either of you had something you've seen about feminism taking a role in helping minorities in gender and sexuality through more difficult periods of time and how it's affected today.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Do you understand the question?
Yes, and I think that... Remember that she told you she was too nice, and I told you I was not accused of being too nice. I'm thinking, for example, in opening the Bell Hicks Institute in a little town in the Bible Belt, we had Laverne Cox as our central guest from Orange is the New Black. And part of why we had Laverne was that she has spoken out about how Bell Hooks' work has shifted her thinking. So that I think that one of the things that we need to highlight more and more are those intersectional dialogues between people who might not talk to one another or know about one another, because I think that also produces a great change. Some of the Christians who had not wanted Laverne to speak because they saw her as an abomination were changed by the radical hospitality we talked about here at St. Norbert's yesterday, her kindness, her generosity of spirit. Going on too long, Bill. It helps to have two names.
Hi, my name is Laurel, and I think all of my friends who know me might have an impression of how I can lead by example as much as I can as to what feminism is, but I'm wondering in a more formal sense, do you have any recommendation as to, you know, what would be a great book for someone who's not very familiar with feminism?
Of course, I'm very prejudiced. I would say feminism is for everybody.
By guess who? Right.
Your name?
Hello. My name is Cynthia, and I'm just so thrilled to be here. Thank you both. I'm a first-generation college student, and I remember those high school days in the 70s. They were great. Anyway, my quick question is, I'm wondering if you could touch on the role of spiritual belief systems, perhaps religious belief systems, might play in the problems that we're dealing with today. Thank you.
Yeah,
I don't know that I should let her talk about this one.
No, I don't think you can help it. I'm going to talk about it. To me, I'm just speaking personally, there's a difference between spiritual and religious. Spiritual seems to me to be a faith in the mystery and the importance and the sacredness of all living things. Religion is a name for politics in the sky. You know, religion is just politics you can't talk about. So God looks mysteriously like the ruling class. God is always a guy. It's always, hierarchical.
See why I didn't want her to answer the question?
Jesus is blonde and blue-eyed, a Jewish guy in the middle of the Middle East, excuse me, you know. It's political. It's political. And patriarchal religion is all about controlling reproduction.
Well, let me say on the positive tip, because I would rather talk about how spirituality nurtures us, how it, I look at my life and I know that without the strong spiritual foundation that I, let's face it, that I formed in the patriarchal black church with the white blue-eyed Jesus looking down at the globe and the people of color at the bottom, I would not be here today. So I encourage all of us to look for those writers and thinkers, both women and men, who are talking, Matthew Fox, for example, about new forms of spirituality and religious practice and religious devotion. Because I think we know what the negative narrative is. We know how it oppresses us. Let's look at the liberatory narratives and what they do for us in daily life. Your question?
Hi, my name's Alexander. I'm a senior here.
Hello, Alex.
Hey, Dr. Hooks. So my question is, as a young person, especially a student of color on a campus such as this, how do we get more students involved in these conversations or in these topics? And starting with the students of color who maybe aren't as aware what's going on or don't really want to talk about because they perceive things as being okay.
Well, I think it comes out of talking to each other, no? I mean, telling the stories of your own lives, your own experience, bringing speakers you admire onto campus. But, you know, just it comes out of honesty about your own lives. You know, how has being a man affected you? How has restricted or liberated? How has racism affected it? Because otherwise we don't see it. You know, we just accept what's around us, and then we replicate it. Do you have a small group of people, a small group of guys or people or people of color or a diverse group that you can tell your own daily life stories to?
Oh, yeah. We have the Holton Multicultural Center. We've done things like the SNC Through Our Eyes Forum, where students of color have come and talked and had conversation about what it's like to be a student, and people have interacted in the audience. But a lot of times, it's those students who are already trying to understand. So how do we reach more so the students who don't necessarily want to understand or are fighting back against it?
Well, I don't think you can reach them if you start off thinking that they don't want to understand. Probably it's more useful to think that they don't understand and that they have fear. And so once again, we go back to Pima saying start where people are. I think it's very crucial if we can figure out, if we think there's someone who doesn't think as we do, what do they think about? What do they want to talk about? And how can you interface with that? Your name?
Hi, my name's Annie, and I'm a student here as well. I'm wondering if you could only choose one phrase to address the anti-feminist or somebody who doesn't believe in feminism, what would that one phrase be?
Well, you have, are you talking to a woman?
Anyone, any anti-feminist.
Well, I confess, I don't know if I should confess this, but sometimes I say, you know, to women, you have a choice. You're a feminist or a masochist. There's nothing else. But often it's just people don't know. I mean, really, literally, sending people to the dictionary is not a bad thing, you know, to figure out what the word means, because, you know, all the people, Rush Limbaugh has been saying feminazi for years and years, you know, people may not just know that it means the full economic political equality of females and males, right?
Your question?
Sure, my name is Katie. I am an alum of the college. Currently this semester I'm taking a class on women's health and sexuality in society, and the biggest thing that I've taken from it, I think, is education and advocacy. What, I guess, is the best way to get that education and advocacy and getting, you know, more control over yourself for your own health care?
Education and empathy, is that your word?
Efficacy, right?
Yeah, advocacy.
Efficacy?
Advocacy?
Advocacy.
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 Hashtag advocacy.
Well, it comes from finding what's unfair in our own lives, I think, and getting that's affecting you and a few other people and changing it. And when you change one thing and you feel powerful, and then you change the next thing and the next. And it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter how small it is. Maybe it's a professor who, in all goodwill, is calling on the guys in the class more than the women in the class. I don't know. Or, you know, whatever the unfairness is, maybe you just need more lights in the parking lot because somebody got assaulted. Whatever it is, you know, to identify it and work together to change it, and then you say, oh, I can do this, and then you go on to the next thing.
And last question.
I'll keep this short. I'm Leah. I'm wondering, what is your biggest criticism of current feminist discourse, and how can we improve it?
I'm tempted to say that we use words like discourse.
That was very bad, Gloria Marie.
No, you know, I'm always threatening to put a big sign on the road to Harvard and Yale that says, "Beware deconstruction ahead," you know?
Of course, she's sitting up here with a consummate deconstructivist.
Now, I wouldn't say, I don't know that I can do that in general. I think we need specificity, because only in the specific can you be helpful and recommend other ways of doing something. Does that make sense?
Well, for me, I wish that every feminist man, woman, boy, girl were talking about the role of love in ending domination, because as I tell audiences frequently, you don't find anybody who loves who's dominating somebody. So if you leave with nothing else, remember that anytime you're doing the work of love, you're doing the work of ending domination. Thank you.
So we welcome all of you to organize and talk and discuss out in the lobby, and also a reminder that the book signing will be directly following this. If you're going to have a book signature, please line up on the right wall. Again, check out the rest of the events in the Bell Hooks Residency on these cards, and thanks again for coming tonight. One more round of applause for these amazing women.